everyone. Oh, it's kind of weird up here. So, welcome to the Manchester NUS Hustings. This is the first time that we've ever done this. So, I'm going to give you a bit of an intro, what we're going to do today, and then we're just going to get started. So, as I said, welcome to the Hustings. We're really happy to host all the candidates vying to be elected for a full-time NUS position. This is how it's going to work. We were going to have each kind of officer remit. They're going to give their opening speeches, two questions that has been submitted to each position. So President, Vice President of Higher Education, Vice President of Union Development, Vice President of Soccer SID, and Vice President of Welfare. And then we'll have like a few minute break. And then we'll then give each, there's also been questions submitted to each individual candidate, and they've got 2 minutes to respond to that so they can come up. It's been fantastic. We've had over 90 questions submitted, so they've been randomly selected, and hopefully they cover a breadth of different topics that students at Manchester and students across the country are interested in for the candidates. So if you want to, any audience member can submit a question just by the tea and coffee, by the question box. And it'll be similar to like question time where you'll submit the question, then we'll pull it out and be like, hello, Michael has a question. Michael, would you like to read your question? And you can sign up and read your question, but only obviously if you've been selected. Great, so why are we having this question time? So our national conference, in our bylaws, our national conference delegates are mandated to vote according to the outcome of a primary election. So this Hustings is kicking off our primary election. The election will be open tomorrow. All Manchester University students will be receiving a email link, and it'll also be on My Manchester. And it's closing on the 17th at 23:45, so quarter to 12 on Sunday evening is when it closes. And then we will announce who our students want to be elected for NUS positions. So it will be on My Manchester, and it will be published on the 18th, and all our delegates will know the results before they leave the National Conference on the 18th evening. So, ground rules. Please remember, we want to make this a really friendly debate, really open, to be able to really talk about the policies and why people think they're the best person for this role. So do not raise personal grievances or disagreements with candidates. Do not speak without recognition of the chair. Confine remarks to the topic under discussion, so don't start bringing up random things that weren't being discussed at that moment. Don't heckle, simple debate rules. And questions are selected randomly, so please don't be offended if a question wasn't selected. We had over 90 questions, which is incredible, which means it's impossible for all those questions to be answered. If candidates want to, when it finishes, you're obviously more than welcome to like have chats, etc. But in this time, we want to have like a really good debate. Awesome. So what I'll do is show the list of the candidates. So, for the different positions, for National President, we have Malia, Megan, and Adil. I haven't seen Adil, but hopefully he's on his way. For Vice President for Education, Shakira Martin, she's unable to attend, and as this is a HE union, and she doesn't vote for further education, I understand why. She might not be necessarily the biggest deal for today. Vice President Higher Education, Priscilla and Sarana are running for the positions. Vice President Suck and Sit, we've got Samaya, Chloe and Robbie. Vice President Union Development, we've got Richard and Sahaya. And for Vice President Welfare, we have Shelley and Munya. Munya unfortunately is unable to be here, but has sent us a video, which I tried to download, still trying to. If not, we'll play at the end. It should be fine, we'll get played at some point. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite up all the candidates for National President. They're going to have 1 minute to introduce themselves, say their speech, and then we've got 2 questions. I have in my trusty envelopes here that I will whip out and read. I don't know which one will be yet. The candidates for National President, please come up. So I'm going to try and do everything in. Yeah? Still stuck in Wales. I will I'm going to do everything alphabetically order, so there's no woohoo bit from us. So, B starts, so it's Malia.
Our education is under attack. We face growing attainment gaps, growing exclusion of marginalised students, cuts in funding, the closing of our colleges, and the undermining of our students' unions. The situation is making students as well as staff feel isolated and often powerless, causing increasing strains on our mental health. We need a national movement that can offer a clear strategy to change the direction of travel in the sector, that puts forward a stronger vision of education, and which breaks our feelings of isolation. We need a united movement which focuses on the tasks at hand, which builds on the strengths of all its parts and refuses to be divided in the face of growing inequality. We need a national movement which puts liberation at the heart of everything that we do, not as a slogan but as a principle, because we understand that after coming for liberation groups, they always come for the rest. We need an end to business as usual. We need to roar as one strong voice. We need a union that transforms both the world and those who take part in it. I'm the candidate that wants to get us there. Vote number one. Vote Malia number one for president. Thank you.
Hi everyone. Firstly, a massive thank you to Manchester Student Union and TUNAR for organising this event. My name is Megan Dunn and I'm running for re-election as NUS National President. This year I have prioritised campaigning against cuts to maintenance grants, a cost of living campaign to support student unions campaigning on their campuses, and campaigning to remain part of the European Union. I've taken on the government, building sector consensus on removing the link between the teaching excellence framework and a rise in tuition fees, giving evidence of the business leverage. I've campaigned alongside the NUT against cuts to sixth form colleges and signed a historic campaign agreement for the Trade Union Congress. Next year, I will work on access to education, from colleges to universities, from universities to postgraduates to PhDs. I will campaign to open up adult learning and reduce educational inequalities. And I will work tirelessly with student unions to protect them from a government that wants to inflict upon us the same restrictions that they have to trade unions. There is so much to do, and I would be privileged to lead this movement again for another year. So Megan Dunn, number one for National President.
Thank you very much. So, moving on to the first question. We are currently facing the most anti-student government we have seen for a while. What are your views on the approach that NUS needs we're taking to deal with this? Megan, you've got it in your hand. Do you want to start?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it is absolutely fair to say that it's been an incredibly difficult year for students in terms of the attacks that the government has launched upon us and upon our unions. And I think that we need to take all approaches and pick the approach that best works for the moment that we need. And I think we need to be a union that is not driven by tactics, but driven by a desire to win and to use the tactics that we need at the time, whether that be lobbying, protesting, direct action, petitions, like whatever it is that we need to do at the time to make an analysis of the thing that will make us win. I am not interested in being seen to do the right thing. I want to do the right thing, and I want to win for the students that really desperately need us.
Thank you.
Can you hear us?
Yeah,
kind of, but not yet. Should we put the mic closer?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, cool. So, yeah, education is under attack. It is, the government is coming after students time and time again. And what's needed now more than ever is a mass united movement. We need to be building on the grassroots. We have a wealth of knowledge, experience, fire and passion within the student movement across the UK, and what we need to be doing is putting our national resources, putting the platforms that we have to those students and to students' unions to help them amplify their efforts locally and feed it into the national picture. I've demonstrated time and time again as an officer through the Black Students Campaign how we're able to do that and how we're able to utilise every method available. it's not about picking one method. We can use all of them, we can engage everybody, and because in reality as well, our efforts need to be totally accessible. I've proven, even just with Prevent alone, that I will access every space I can. I will take to the streets, I will lobby in Parliament, I will even take it to the United Nations if necessary. I will use every space and I engage every student that feels a part of it, and to ensure that, any mobilisation that does take place doesn't feel exclusive, doesn't feel out of touch, and by extension facilitating spaces where we understand what those key issues are and how those attacks are actually directly affecting students, because at times students may feel that things are being put forward to them as opposed to us implementing changes and relative resources in relation to their particular needs.
Thank you very much. So the next question is, what are your views on the level of power that the president has? What are your views on the level of power that the president currently has?
People often ask me about that. If you were to have all this power, what would you do? I think one of the main things would be to work as a collective team. I think it's very important that as president, I ensure that power is shared, that people feel equal access to resources, and they can see that whatever campaigns are put out by the NUS, it is collective by all the relative officers, liberation, sections, zones, and so on, who have been electing those positions, because within, whether it's putting out statements, whether it's mobilizing on particular campaigns, whether it's articulating what the actual needs of students are and what directions that we're going to take. So really, I'll use my power to essentially amplify the efforts of our whole movement and all our FTOs and all the parts of the National Union itself.
Thank you very much.
There is always a lot of conversation around like what is NUS, where does power lie within NUS, and I think that I've been really clear this year that the power needs to lie with the people who need us the most, and those are students, unions, and through them their members are students. And I don't think that this is about who holds power within NUS. I think it's about how we put our members at the centre of our campaigns, how we build their power up, how we support them in their campaigns, and how we come together to provide the strongest movement to take on a government that is relentlessly attacking us, and to provide a voice for students that really do need us.
Thank you very much. So I'd like to give a round of applause to the President John Howard. Mention was this is also being filmed in two different ways. We have our fantastic Fuse FM student media group who are filming. So this will be released, edited and released by midnight tonight, so you can all share it and share all your fantasy great moments. It's also being live streamed on Periscope at Manchester SU if you want to share with your friends, people want to come and watch the debate. And also you can follow what's going on with the hashtag Manchester, NUS Hustings MCR Naturals, if you want to follow on with the debate, any comments, etc. You might be taking Twitter comments if you want to. Okay, so next up, I'd love to get the candidate for Vice President of Higher Education, Silvana Serrano, if you'd like to take the stage. Thank you.
Isolating, degrading, and financially cutting. Students and delegates, tell me if you can trust an NUS that champions democracy but leaves students out of pocket if they decide to run. Tell me if you can trust an NUS that talks of inclusion but has political lines so entrenched that I can't get people not on my side to talk to me. I was told not to run for BPHE because I would not fit in. Reps, I'm the first black woman president at an 800-year-old institution. I have made it my job to take the rug from under tradition. I'm running because I'm impatient. When George Osborne wants to retrospectively rob students, you tell me if you think NUS is doing enough. I serve 55 student unions, 22,000 Cambridge students, and I won't let NUS fail them or you. Equality cannot just be a social justice tagline. It must bleed into every economic and political structure if we want all students to hold an equal stake in HE. NUS is doing a lot, but it can be doing it better. That's enough reason to run.
Hi everyone, I'm Sarana, I'm the current Vice President of Higher Education at NUS. Last year, I didn't just run to piss off Nigel Farage with my militant Romanian self. I ran to prioritise access and liberation within an active higher education zone. And this year wasn't just business as usual. We told the minister to tap off and that quality doesn't grow on fees, but on our terms. We rolled out Liberate My Degree, giving students resources to transform teaching and learning on the ground. And we didn't just fight, but we won. The Caps Off campaign won access to postgrad loans for students over 30 and reduced the repayment rate. The PME attainment gap is becoming key in access agreements, and government want to work with us on tackling it at postgrad level too. But there's so much more to do. And my vision for next year is to defend education as a public good, not allowing politicians' egos to create an even more divided and inaccessible education system. I want students to build a liberated education that works for all and not just a privileged few. If you do too, then stick with Sarana for BPHE.
Thank you very much. So, the first question is, the University of Manchester is the biggest SU with over 1,000 student reps. What will you do to help support these part-time volunteers, not just our education officer?
Hi, excellent. This year we have run two very, very successful regional course rep conferences where we've trained over 360 student activists, one took part in Leeds and one took part in London. And a key pledge in my manifesto going forward next year is that I want to extend this program of regional events so that we upskill and train course reps in order to transform teaching and learning on the ground and become more active, as well as a way to be building avenues to be resisting government reforms, but as well as tackling local issues and how NUS could support you better. And also, all the campaigns that were launched this year have been created with an online hub on NUS Connect that breaks down either the Quality Doesn't Grow on Fees campaign, so that's against the Green Paper or Liberate My Degree, have had specific resources that were aimed at students and not just sabbatical officers, with the tools that you can then take on and run events on your campuses, so kind of train the trainer scheme. So in order to make NUS a national campaign, it's less daunting and way more easier to get involved with. But I know face-to-face break makes way more better than online resources, so I think NUS should be doing way more to be on the ground, and this is a key pledge for me going forward next year.
Brilliant question, and I do believe that the NUS should be on the ground. I think it should be meeting the students and student reps. Like I said, I work with 55 undergraduate, postgraduate, and mature students' unions. I go to a collegiate university where there are 31 colleges, and for me, it is exactly about that, going and meeting the reps of every single executive students' union and providing workshops and training, liaising, writing those joint agreements that go towards our students' union, but also towards our university. And so the idea is, it's about what the students need from NUS. And I would seek to, like with one of my main manifesto points, is looking at the BME attainment gap, but looking at attainment gaps within a model and asking students' unions, what is your attainment gap? Where do you think the problems lie? Okay, I'm going to work with you to figure out what the answers are. So the idea is, what I need from NUS is bespoke, tailor-made support for my union and I imagine that's how every single union feels, and that's what I would so go on to do. Because I know this year, being at a collegiate institution, sometimes it's been like, oh, you guys have this college structure, we're just gonna back away because we don't really get it. And I know now that whether that's going to be sort of a smaller institution that's of the arts, or if that's going to be a modern institution or like mine, an ancient institution, the idea is I will be able to provide that support that is tailored to what those students need.
The last question is, as with BHE, would you support free education?
Absolutely. That is exactly what the student movement is about. It's not only NUS's policy, but it's very clear, it's exactly what we need. It's happened in other countries, it most certainly can happen here. Of course it will take more than just a year. I think we should both agree, potentially it's not gonna happen during our time. And for me, I only run for positions when I have a clear idea of how I want to get things done and get the ball rolling. The reason I didn't run at Cambridge, for example, is because I ticked up my manifesto points, and that's why I'm here, because I believe I have something to offer to the national movement. I believe that right now we are in a race to the top. That's a discussion about international fees, it's a discussion about postgraduate fees, and it's about how we get, us getting free education is about thinking about that race at the bottom. How are we ensuring that we are not having students coming into HE who are commodifying themselves and thinking, I want to get my value for money out of this? That's where it starts, at the ground as well as from the top down. So that's what I'd be keen to be working on.
Thank you for that. I am a vocal supporter of free education. I've been on my manifesto twice, when I ran first year and this time again. And I've been part of the campaign 2 years ago in passing free education policy at national conference as well, so I'm very glad that our organisation has it. And I'm a firm believer in free education, not because I think it would be a solution to access on its own, but actually I think a system of tuition fees is driving the wrong behaviours within our universities. It pits them against each other and creates a competitive environment where they care more about recruiting students than actually supporting them and keeping them in and giving them a good education. It makes universities invest more in marketing, really nice shiny brochures, open days, rather than actually investing money in teaching and learning and mental health support and the kinds of things that our students need in order to thrive. It would mean that we treat education as a public good, and it is what it is. Education is a force to be changing society, and it serves communities, and it serves societies, and therefore it should be free. And we should be building momentum towards that, and considering that all public funding is being turned into loans, but now if graduates fail to be repaying their loans, they fiddle with loan repayment terms, or they're trying to sell off the loan book, because they've realised the system is unsustainable, and if the money doesn't come back, it doesn't result in any sort of public funding. So you might as well publicly fund it. If the majority of population is currently entering HE, which is the case, there's an argument to be made that it should be publicly funded, and I believe that should be the case, and a core aim of NUS.
Thank you very much. Next up. Are the candidates for Vice President Sutton Smith. I'm about to invite Chloe Samaya Murray to the stage.
We've always played a key role in shaping society, and we're still at the forefront of movements campaigning for social justice, whether this is in welcoming refugees, protecting the NHS, divesting from unsustainable futures, or championing equality and the defence of civil liberties in the fight against institutional discrimination. I'm running because students reject the top-down narrative of citizenship that feeds xenophobia, that promotes conformity to British values as a way of putting people into boxes. I'm running actually because I'm sick of seeing people who look like me dragged across national media, treated as though we don't belong here, so I'm running to redefine citizenship. But most importantly, I'm asking you to put your trust in me as a vice president, because I've worked tirelessly as a student, as a volunteer, and as a sub, and I'm going to take the work that I've done national on international solidarity, on refugees, prevent developing hate crime reporting centres and supporting FE and HE student unions campaign together in what is an incredibly hostile environment. And those are a few of my ideas, but obviously I have lots more, so I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chloe. I'm the two-year president, second-year president at Bournemouth University, and I sit on NUS Young Development Zone. I'm running because I see NUS as an organisation that's got so much potential, and I've only really realised probably in the last year, not only for individual students, but also like our place in society of lobbying for free education and kind of teaching students about social justice and championing that, we have so much potential to make society really, really like such a better place, and I think we're not making the most of that at the moment. I think we spend too much time in the US worrying about picking sides and worrying about who's right, who's wrong, and trying to get one over on each other. And I think we don't spend enough time actually about the students that we're elected to represent, and I think we're letting them down by doing that. And I really do believe, from kind of who I am and my track record in my university, I really do believe that I've got a chance to try and change that culture. And it's a big thing it's a bit ambitious, but I think if I can do it, I don't think anyone can. I'm running Society and Citizenship, so I realise that a lot of the stuff that I've done in my time as president has kind of led on to this kind of area, from bringing environmental agenda to the forefront into my university, to doing things such as lobbying to get £1 million for birth bursaries, and I believe that the work I've done, I'm really, really ready to take it nationally. And I think we have a lot to do to kind of, the work we've done lobbying nationally has been really, really good in this area. We have a lot to do to kind of take a step back. Think about our students who are every day campaigning for the living wage, who are doing environmental campaigns, refugee campaigns, and actually show them that us as NUS, we're there to support them, and through that we can tell them that they are political. I feel like this role has a real ability to show students just how much they can change and how much power they've got through what they're already doing. I think we need to stop prescribing what the issues are, and we need to step back and listen to students all around the UK, see what they need from NUS, through that, show them that they can make a difference and they have got a lot of power together. And yeah,
thank you very much. Thank
you. Hi, so I'm Robbie, and for the past 2 years I've had the pleasure of being the NUS LGBT Plus Officer in place, and I'm standing now to be Vice President of Society and Citizenship. NUS has changed my life. It's given me chances as a working class boy from Coventry we don't often get. It's taught me how to campaign. It's shaped my politics, and it's given me the confidence to sit here today. I'm going to say stand up, stand down. And also, it gave me the confidence to come out as a proud gay man. The NUS isn't doing enough for activists like us in the movement. It expects you to go on the political journey that I had all on your own, and that needs to change. I'm standing to make the Society and Citizenship Zone more relevant to students by campaigning for sustainable unions, fairer unions, and political unions. The fact that the Society and Citizenship Zone is at the bottom of the priority ballot shows that this needs to change. The fact that FE has had no priority campaign in this zone needs to change. And I'm standing to change this. I have the experience, the knowledge and the passion to transform the Society and Citizenship Zone, and I look forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
First question is, NUS focuses a lot on political campaigners in their unions. How have, or will you, help to empower other types of activists to achieve all sorts of change in their students' unions? Has it got the right effect?
Sure, yeah. So one of my manifesto points is about bringing in activist training days. And as a liberation officer, I plan liberation activist training days 2 years now in the North and South. And this year, the very first time I took an LGBT activist training day over to Northern Ireland. And that's about bringing people on the journey that I had. If it wasn't for LGBT politics, I wouldn't be here. And being a liberation campaigner has brought me to this point. And I think that everyone in NUS should have a chance to do that. So whether that's writing a motion to your council, whether that's going to an academic board, whether that's taking to the streets, lobbying MPs, like talking to your local assembly members or politicians, we need to learn how to be activists. We need to learn how to do that. And NUS needs to teach people how to. So if elected, as opposite, I will work on my manifesto point. I'm bringing activist training days into every nation, and hopefully the North and South of England, to make sure that everyone has a chance at activism and knows how to campaign.
I actually developed as an activist completely outside NUS, and it was only when I really started to understand the way that certain things on campus were affecting me more than they were maybe affecting other people that I then went to NUS, went to the Black Students campaign, and absolutely felt at home there. And I think that we need to be able to make sure that more students have access to NUS. I really don't. I understand that there are things in place, but I think that when we have conferences that are so exclusive, that you only go to once or twice a year, that are only for staff, when the message isn't really getting there to students and student unions. And I think NUS needs to broaden its approach. And I think that SUs do a really, really good job, you know, with societies, with campaigns, grassroots campaigns. Students get active on their own. I think it's just that we're not able to support them as well as we should.
So the question was, NUS focuses a lot on political campaigners in their unions. How have you or will you help to empower other types of activists to achieve all sorts of change in their students' union?
Okay, in terms of how have I, I genuinely believe in my 2 years as president that I've completely changed how students see us as their representatives. Like 2 years ago, people used to stand for election because they thought it was a popularity contest and they didn't really have any idea what a SAB did or what your parking officers did. And I've really noticed the change in 2 years, students standing because they really want to change something and they really want to make a difference. And like some of the president candidates talked about NUS in their elections this year. Like that would have never happened 2 years ago. And I know, like, I don't want to sound arrogant, but I genuinely know that that's my influence. I genuinely know that I've changed that culture. And I'm confident in my ability to do it nationally as well. In terms of kind of what you said about political campaigners, I feel like we need to stop describing what an activist is and what political means. And because I think it turns people who don't associate themselves with that off. And we need to look at all of our volunteers, all of our fundraisers, all of our students that are running environmental campaigns, refugee campaigns, and start working with them and start listening with them. And I feel like me as a Vice President of Society and Citizenship, I'm both supporting them like on the ground, like locally, as well as lobbying nationally on their behalf. So let's say the environment, for example, if I'm supporting students who are doing environmental work around the UK, and then I'm also taking that as a mandate and lobbying nationally for something, and I achieve something, I feel like those students will know that they achieved it too, and I feel like that's how we get people political, and that's how we get people active, and realising that they really can make a difference. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Okay. I'll pick this one because I think it's quite helpful. What have you done, what will you do for voter registration this year? What will you do as a vice president next year to make sure that no student falls off the electoral register? Chloe, do you want to start?
One thing I've been thinking about voter registration recently, and it's on my manifesto point. I think the main thing, this is no criticism at all to NUS, but I feel at the moment, as a spastic officer, it will be a referendum or an election will be coming up, and 3 months beforehand, we'll just get a pack of the post, like with some materials, which is great, like it's not a problem, but I'm wondering if we're actually achieving anything. Like, are we just engaging with the students that are already going to vote and they're already going to register to vote, and we're just kind of saying that we've done something? If I was elected, I feel like we need to take a step back and actually have like a long term, like a year or 2 year or 3 year strategy, and think, what are we actually doing now to engage our students in politics? And what can we be doing better? And what is each individual union in the country or in the UK doing? And how we engage our students currently and what can we do? So I think in terms of registration, obviously that's just one part of that, but I do generally think we need to take a proper step back and have like a long-term strategy in NUS of how are we gonna get our students engaged in politics? So I think what we're doing at the moment just isn't working.
Thank you.
Registration campaigns are actually really important steps in engaging students within national politics, regardless of where, you know, where they are, whether they're in England, Scotland, Northern Ireland, or elsewhere. And I think focusing on that is a good thing. However, there's a really good point if we're not expanding our efforts to engage those who don't have an equal chance to address the government, whether that's votes at 16 or the disenfranchisement of like such a large majority of NUS students. Many of whom, you know, massively affected by FE area reviews, but yet don't have that avenue open to them to be able to influence any change. So at Bradford SU, we've worked with our local FE college, SU, on every single one of our voter registration campaigns. We've held hustings in the run-up to general elections. We had a massive Team Bradford Votes campaign last year. And in 2010, you know, I started my kind of journey into the student movement was through making sure that the MPs can get elected in my local area. So, you know, I think there's lots to be done, but I think if I'm elected, I think I'm gonna really prioritise with the VP, I think, to ensure the diversity of ethnic students is prioritised and their civic engagement is not lost in a really HE-centric voter registration approach. And I really want to research voter alienation as well and find out what are the deep-seated issues that people can feel passionate about, because I was there in Bradford when a certain person came to in 2012, led a by-election, and you know, got loads of young people to vote. Rightly or wrongly, you know, what he did with that vote doesn't really matter, but it's the fact that he managed to engage so many people. So I want to follow this research over regional forums, getting every single student able to feel like they can make a change, go to their local MP and be able to hold them to account, as well as MEPs as well. And I think that some of the things that I've tried to do in Bradford as well, and on MP shadowing as well, little things like that are really, really important. I think it's important to make sure that that's replicated in other places across the UK. Thank you very much.
I guess this year I worked with the shadow cabinet member for voter registration and young people, Gloria DiPiero, to get student unions and students registered to vote from both the university and student union level. One of the things I want to do is get institutions to automatically sign students up straight away, so they're straight away on the electoral roll. You know that the individual voter registration is knocked off millions in the voter register, but more, and we know these people are likely to be working class and from marginalised areas of the society, and so therefore not being able to help, not being there to hold their local politicians to account. That's something that absolutely has to change, and I think the Mr. Millions campaign done alongside with this was something that I'm proud to have worked on this year. As well, I want to work on Basic 16. I think where there's taxation, there should absolutely be representation, and there's so much happening to students in girl education that we should be working on, and that's where I want to put FD as a priority, with Basic 16 as my priorities. And also the EU referendum, we know is coming up, and we absolutely have to have students registered to vote. We know that young people want to remain in the EU, and it's old people who want to leave. And if young people aren't going and taking the fight to the ballot box, then we may lose our rights really as citizens, especially if we vote to leave the EU. So I think there's a lot to be done around getting institutions registered to vote automatically. I think that's huge. We should be doing a Vote 16, and like I say, we need to be making a very progressive case for remaining in Europe and making sure that students are registered to vote.
Thank you very much. Thank you for listening. So the next ones we'll have up are Vice President Union Development candidates. Come on up.
The sad little secret is that whilst I was a student at University of Hull, you can see the culture, 2017, and 2017 will be amazing, and an elected student leader as well, is that I didn't particularly like NUS very much, and a lot of the reasons for that will be the reasons that a lot of you feel as well, which is around how distant it felt on my campus and how I didn't feel like it made an impact on my or other students' lives. But in the same way that if your student union feels incapable of change, you go and change it, and if you didn't think something that represents you that should have, you should take charge of that, and I think it's the same with NUS. And I think in that vein, you judge the elected leaders of those institutions by three main things, and it's how much they care, how hard they try, and how much they change. And I think that my work on the impact of student opportunities, on further education, learning, voice, student development, NUS's strategy, and Love SUs, shows that all three of those things have happened. But this election isn't going to be about who cares the most, because ultimately we both care very much, or who would try the hardest, because I think we both would try incredibly hard. It's about who can deliver that change that they promise. And I think that's shown through the biggest redistribution of resources within NUS in further education and then voice student development. I can do that. In breaking down the false dichotomies between student opportunities and student activism, I've done that. And by championing NUS democratic reform and student unions as bastions of progressive change. And I'd really like the opportunity to do it again. So thank you very much.
Hi everyone, so I'm a young professor, so first of all, my name is Sahaya and I'm from Manchester SU inviting me to this great event. So, like some of the people who make up our group, when you rarely meet at NUS events here, make motions at conference, I'm an FE student. The vast majority of our members are an under-resourced FE union, which in most cases barely exists. When I was a college president, I had no support. We had no labs, no staff, no autonomy, and a management who didn't want us to be active. When I needed help, I turned to the one body who I thought was an enemy, the NUS. But they weren't. All they did was plug yet another expensive, inclusive event that wasn't available to me, and my union could not afford to send me to. My experience is far from unique, and this is because NUS has the wrong priorities. Focusing on brands, benchmarks, and SAB networking instead of engaging on mass membership and getting the basics right. Unions throughout the zone should prioritize transforming our unions into democratic collectives capable of fighting for the rights of all our members, whether they're international students faced with deportation, Muslim students being targeted by threat, or working class students, disabled students whose vital funds have been cut. And now as we face government attacks on our unions, this is becoming ever more urgent. We must mount a campaign so strong that those in power have no choice but to listen.
Do you think the NUS should be worried about the keeping power of unaccountable trustee boards over student unions?
So how do we get started?
Yes, I definitely think that there is, without democracy, I think democracy is what basically gives our movement both legitimacy as well as real power, because it's truly democratic collectives that we're able to actually not only debate what we want to stand for as a movement, but actually put forward our priorities and actually campaign for change. And I do think that with all sort of things that would basically threaten the true democracy of FE student unions, this is a real threat. I have to say, this is not an issue that I personally know a huge amount about, but I do believe that, basically, true democracy needs to be ensured. And I think that what's a real issue is when we have a national union of students, where the vast majority of our students, like I said, don't actually even have any kind of elected representation. So as much as I think that there are many ways in which we need to improve democracy in HE unions, where management and staff still dictate how student unions are run in FE, where they exist at all, I think our priority needs to be in actually building up strong democratic resourced FE unions.
Thank you.
That's an interesting one. So I think student unions should for the benefit of students. And I think the thing that gets confused about the debate that we have here is the difference between having well-run sustainable student unions and then having student unions run by students, and actually they're not mutually exclusive concepts, and people forget actually that student unions is a thing, this building and the student union here in Manchester and other places. A lot of them, in particular 10, 20, 30 years ago, before they had gardens, before they had things like trustee boards, were actually in dire financial straits. They were going under, they weren't around, they couldn't do anything because they didn't have any money. And actually trustee boards, if we're talking about that in particular, should always have a president as a chair, should always have the majority of students on that trustee board. But yeah, I do believe actually in external trustees, I do believe in well-governed student unions. And I won't apologise for that, because I know that student unions in the past have came on a massive journey where they basically didn't exist before and they couldn't and weren't doing things for the benefit of their students. The only other thing I want to mention was that is a, obviously for the majority of membership, this has already been outlined, this isn't a question for them. And actually, when we talk about trustee boards, it's obviously an incredibly higher education thing. And one of the things that I think actually is probably just as, if not more important, is about the autonomy of FE student unions and how you give the power to what's often one lone voice of a student governor and a board of governors in an FE college. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Right, so the next question is, are demos the best way to achieve change in our SUs and society?
I mean, they're not the only way, would be my answer to that. I have organised demonstrations, I've been on demonstrations, I have been a part of lots of direct action, I'm very proud to have been, and in particular in 2010, with the tuition fees demonstrations, I felt like the student movement and the people I was with could like take over the world, because it felt like that. Are they the best way? I think that's kind of a forced choice because, and this argument's already been had on this table, is you can use any number of given different tactics depending on the time and what works right. So every good campaign should always have the opportunity to be involved in direct action, to be involved in being on the streets comrades and all of that bit. But they should also have the opportunity to be lobbying in the boardroom and doing that stuff as well. And sustainable change is only made when you use all of those things, as has been said before by a number of different candidates.
So again, as has been said, obviously demonstrations in isolation don't change anything. They're important as part of a wider strategy. The wider strategy of variety of tactics, including direct action and a range of other things. However, I think it is also important to actually look at what are the tactics that have actually won the sort of fundamentals that we actually have today as students. Most of the things we take for granted, such as our student unions, have actually been won through direct action, whether that is like occupations or an actual building for your student union, or actually taking direct action for greater control and democracy and autonomy as a student union. So I think as much as we do need the diversity of tactics, it is actually vitally important to actually recognise where actually our power lies as a movement, and that is in our ability to collectively organise.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Last but not least, we'll invite up Shelley, BB Welfare. Obviously, this section will be a bit shorter as there are two candidates.
Did we get the video?
We'll work as a break and get the video that we're missing. What I'll do is, I'll give you, if you have 1 minute to do stuff, and then I'll just ask you the two questions. After, there'll be a break. If you do want to submit any questions, please do have please do. We'll have a few minutes break to get any questions, have some tea and coffee, and we'll start with them in the individual questions.
Okay, so that's your one. I'm going to give you your name tag. I don't know if anyone can read the name tag, it's really nice. Let's there anyway. Now you know.
Okay.
I'm Shelley, I'm the Vice President of Welfare, and in 2010 I too was a thresher marching on Millbank. But I remember NUS as the organisation that let us down, sold us out and criminalised our activists. Some might say that I've now sold out, but actually my mind has changed and I've been proud to run principled and political campaigns this year. I've launched a mental health manifesto and if I'm re-elected I want to build this into access agreements. I've helped run Students Not Suspects workshops across the UK and launched a legal challenge to prevent, and if I'm re-elected I want to set up a legal helpline for student unions. I've published a national report on rents and secured sanctions on rogue landlords, and if I'm re-elected I want to establish a national student tenants union. I've funded action in defence of bursaries and grants, and if I'm re-elected, I want to host a national NHS summit and campaign for students' access to benefits. 10 years ago, NUS was silent on prevent. 6 years ago, we failed to fight for free education, and 12 months ago, we had no plan to tackle the national student mental health crisis. We've come far, but not far enough, so I'm seeking re-election to continue fighting with you in defence of our welfare state. So please vote Shelley, number one for welfare.
Thank you very much. My first question, I think it just reflects what you just said, is tackling the lack of funding and support in student mental health is becoming one of the top priorities on campuses. What have you done this year on mental health, and what do you plan on doing if elected?
Okay, there's been a lot of different things done on mental health from different perspectives. So the first thing we did at the beginning of the year was launch some research, because actually it was an area that we didn't have loads of knowledge about. We didn't know what students were facing day to day with their mental health struggles. And we put that research together, did a national survey, and we took it to Parliament. So the NUS has an all-party parliamentary group on students, and that was one of the key areas that we looked at this year. We also, off the back of collating all of the policy that we've got on mental health, that's from every liberation campaign, all the nations, as well as the national conference, I put together a mental health manifesto. This is something I've been presenting to sector conferences, whether that's UUK or HEFCE, and talking to sector leaders about the change we need to see in mental health, which isn't just about them raising awareness and talking about mental health stigma, but actually pumping money into the services, because further education colleges don't even have counselling services, the ones in HU being cut back. This needs to be a huge priority, And going forward next year, as I say, I want to build this into access agreements. It's not okay for institutions just to say they're going to recruit disabled students. They actually need the support there for them once they get in the door. And I also want to look at Office of Mental Health as well, because there's been a lot of talk this year about student union officers and activists, part-time officers, who really struggle with their own mental health and getting the job done. So I've worked with our women's officer on the self-care workshop this year, but I also want to build that into our officer training and part-time officer training.
Thank you very much. Was submitted by an anonymous student sex worker, and they said, what is your position on sex work and decriminalisation, and how will you ensure that NUS continues to fight for the rights of student sex workers and their welfare?
Great question. So my position is I'm pro-decriminalisation, but this is an issue that I haven't been massively aware of over the last couple of years. It's definitely a political issue that's very new to me, and I think it's actually quite new to the student movement as well, which I think is a really good thing. I think it's fantastic that people are talking about sex work more, and I'm really pleased actually that the women's campaign has taken this up. I think this is something that quite squarely sits with women's campaigns. It's predominantly women that are accessing the sex work industry, although not exclusively. And that's absolutely a welfare issue as well, and something we need to be talking about. I think there's been a piece of research, I don't know if it's come out yet, but our women's place LGBT officer, Anne Swan, and our women's officer have put out a piece of research to find out the experiences of student sex workers. A bit like mental health, it's one that we don't necessarily know loads about, and that's been something that I've been pushing for people to sign up to and promote it. So I'd like to see what the results of that are and how we can work together to respond to the recommendations of it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So we're going to have a few minute break. Oh, I'm on time, it's 7 o'clock. Then a 5 minute break, have some tea, coffee, put any questions that you might have to submit, and then we will be inviting up all the individual candidates for their one question that was submitted earlier. So yeah, we've got 5 minutes, enjoy it. Okay, great. So this is the section where we'll be some students submitted individual questions to different officers, and we've also collated some of the questions that you all in the audience asked. Just the same time stuff. I will say, if you've written your name down, I will say who submitted it and then say the question. But some of them are for individuals, so I will say if it's for an individual or for both of you to answer. Okay? So, the first one that's catching my eye is from Alia. Most students know NUS is an abstract entity and are not very familiar with the national student politics. How can you help to build a stronger connection between students and NUS?
So one of the practical ways that we can change that is by creating formal spaces of engagement. I think it's been stated time and time again that some of our training spaces, some of our conferences that exist are quite exclusive because they come with a considerable fee, because they are held in certain inaccessible places across the UK, which students, particularly from ethnic backgrounds, let's say, cannot necessarily access. So one of the ways that I would change that would be to provide regional networks. This is not just for students, but also SABs, those involved, activists, even local community activists that want to be involved in the bigger picture to defend our education. I think these would be networking spaces which are free, which are regional, so that there would be far less issues in terms of access, and beyond that we can also provide support for travel if necessary, particularly for FE students. I think this is really important because facilitating those spaces of conversation would also allow all students, all activists, all SABs to feel like NUS is being driven by them on the ground because of the various stories and issues that we're collating within those spaces. I've done it through the Black Students Campaign, through the Black SABs networks, through regional activist networks, and we've managed to create collaborations between students' unions. We managed to team up further in higher education sabbatical officers and share resources and experiences. But beyond that as well, we've demonstrated that it's a space led by the students themselves. themselves, and that we are merely sharing those resources and facilitating that process.
Thank you very much. And this question, this question is for Megan. Can you explain what, if any, effect your campaign had this year?
This was the first time that this government was put to the test on a student issue, and the campaigning work that NUS led meant that we lobbied over 200 MPs, over 100 student unions came to Westminster, and the government majority was cut to 11 after they were forced to have not one but three debates when they first tried to hide the decision to cut maintenance grants in a committee of only 18 people. And that is the campaign that I led, and I was incredibly, I was devastated about the result, as I think the entirety of the student movement was. But I think it is worth saying the effects that we had. We have built new alliances with new parties that we've never had to deal with, including the SNP, all of whom voted with NUS. For the first time in their history, the UUP voted against the Conservative Party, a party with which they have an electoral pact, and they voted with NUS, and as did the DUP, which is a massive achievement given that they're appalling and usually stand against everything that NUS stands for. So convincing them is a big win. And I think that we have to recognise the situation that we are in and look at the progress we have to make, and we have to keep building on this. As well as this, I support student unions locally, and with our briefings on cutting hidden course costs out of campuses, Southampton Solent have managed to create a bursary pot of £200,000 to help students with hidden course costs. At the University of Ulster Union have managed to, for the first time, their student nurses and ambulance drivers used to have to pay £800 for injections that they needed to take part in their course. Those will now be paid by the institution. We have given advice to colleges, particularly on the costs of travel, and New College Stamford and College Marion before have managed to campaign for free bus passes for their students. As well as that, the lobbying work that I've done nationally has had a massive effect. The evidence that I gave to the BizLet Committee on the link between the teaching excellence framework and tuition fees, the Select Committee have come back and agreed with my evidence that link is not only short-sighted but incredibly dangerous and damaging to the future of higher education. So yes, absolutely, I think the campaign that I have done this year has had a massive effect.
I'll read out both these questions, and for both of you that have been submitted here. First one is from Sean. It says, at NUS, you represent thousands of students, yet at NUS elections, very few people run, and in some elections, like LGBT+, they were uncontested. What are your feelings on this, and do you feel this represents NUS's ethos? So that's basically when elections don't have many candidates.
Yeah, I think that just like in a student union, if your elections aren't contested, then there is a question to be asked about yourselves, and that goes for elections that aren't particularly contested. And I think that there are a couple of things. I think that NUS for a long time has been on sort of a bit of a precipice in terms of how it involves its members in its democracy. And one of the things that I have started to do this year is to try and put student unions at the heart of what we do, make them feel ownership over NUS as an organisation that belongs to our members, and the concerns that we are talking about are relevant to students. Whether that be campaigning on travel costs or hidden course costs or whatever it is that our students are campaigning on, they should have a voice in our union. And I think there is something to do with the culture of our politics as well, and that is that there is a huge amount of social media abuse, and like, I am the 9th woman president of NUS, and I can tell you why women don't run for this job, and that is the, and for those of you who want it, there's a bit of a content note here. The death threats and the rape threats and the harassment and the abuse that you get every single day makes this an incredibly difficult job to do. Unless what you do is develop an incredibly thick skin and decide that you don't care about people. And actually, I think we want people running for these positions that do care about people.
and that care about the people that I represent. And so this year I am doing something about it, and we have started an anti-social media campaign that talks about the abuse that students and student officers get. It found that nearly 50% of students have experienced abuse online, and that 35% of that is directed to people because of their appearance, and that for 40% of students, it means that they are less likely to be involved in debates, and that is not the political culture that we should be creating, and we have to be working to be tackling that both within NUS and to support student unions to tackle it on their campuses as well. So that's what I'm doing to help solve the problem. Thank you.
So I think some of the reasons are that students generally, I think we're feeling a sentiment of discontent, feelings that maybe that NUS isn't necessarily a space which is relevant or that is arming us with the resources related to local campaigns, related to our local issues. I think one of the ways to address that is, for example, in relation to the regional network, is by us feeding directly the information that we collect from students' issues, feeding it into our national picture, feeding it into our national priorities, and making sure that it very much feels student and students' union led. Beyond that, I think that the disengagement also particularly affects those from liberation backgrounds. And you've seen in some of the conferences that have taken place are predominantly liberation campaigns, and it's not a criticism of the liberation campaigns themselves, actually. It's because those willing to put themselves forward are very aware of the inherent barriers that exist within our union and our wider movement. And that is very much, it manifests into social media abuse, but beyond that as well, makes the work of liberation officers very, very difficult, because you find that the efforts are twofold. You're both having to convince your national body itself to prioritize, quite literally, as is always stated, saving lives, in the matter of all liberation groups, but beyond that as well, taking an incredibly radical and progressive line nationally to dismantle barriers across society. I think that we have the opportunity to make NUS relevant by putting students at the heart of it, by making their voices and their issues and their concerns, by feeding that into the practical resources and spaces that we can offer, by sharing national platforms. We are one of the most powerful organisations in the UK. If we can't affect that change, if we can't make students, if students don't feel that we have that strength, that we have that power through this organisation, then by God, what are we doing? And I think that we also have a collective responsibility to ensure that our union is accessible and is a space that everybody feels that they can engage in, and we shouldn't necessarily be pinning it on a certain section of NUS or a certain officer, for example. Actually, to David Cameron has no idea what he means when he uses "we're in this together." We are within NUS, within the movement. We are in this together. And I think that one of the other things that has come up is not allowing for political, differences to play out. But rather it becoming very much a space of personal attacks. And I think that we have an opportunity to change this culture, and that hopefully we'll start that from this national conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So we have one last question, and it is, how will you be voting in the trans motion? And how did you vote last year if you were there?
Solidarity with self-defining students, trans students, and we will be doing everything that we can to also encourage many delegates to support this. And beyond that, we have also be generally creating spaces of discussion around this into wider society.
So last year I voted against a full-time trans officer, and I did so because the LGBT campaign had voted against having a full-time trans officer, as by the laws of the LGBT campaign. But one of the first things that I did when I came into office as president was to sit down with both of the LGBT plus officers and talk about a way forward, how it was that they could work together to find a solution that suited the LGBT plus campaign. And this year I'll proudly be voting for a trans officer.
Thank you very much, both of you. You are free to leave if you want to. Just a round of applause and thank both of them. So one thing I forgot to mention before we start the break again is obviously it's being live streamed and there are about 70 people watching, so that's great. Everyone watching have a look at your faces. 70? Everyone's watching what's going on, and I haven't seen that hashtag on Twitter, but keep going at it. So next up, I think I'll call Henchi. Going to order that I was before, so Henchi. So you both have individual questions. Weirdly enough, no one here submitted a question, don't have a registration, so just saying. But it's okay, but we both got a question that was already submitted to you online. So, the first one is, I'll go Priscilla, first one next to me. What's the biggest challenge, in your opinion, to the student's reason? So what's the biggest challenge to the student's reason?
That is a wonderful question. I will go back and actually echo some of the things that I think Malia and Megan had to answer with regards to uncontested elections. I think one of the biggest problems with the student movement at the moment is the level of uncontested elections and the lack of vibrancy. New people do not want to get involved. And I say this because I've had to find my voice running in this election. People have said to me directly, like, why are you running against an incumbent? As if to say it's like a personal thing. Spoke to Saran about it, it's not personal, I want the job. Like, Saran was very much not in my consideration when I decided to go for it. But the question as it's posed to me is, how could you so and so an incumbent by running? Now, that's not the democracy that I understand, or the democracy I want to be part of. If we can't encourage students to get involved, we can't encourage students to run, then clearly something is going wrong. This election is quite clear to me that NUS has a lot to work on. I put together like a 3-month plan of the kind of things I want to get done. And indeed, for me to move forward as BPHE, one of the main things I want to do is work with the UD officer. One thing I need to see done before the end of my term would be to look at ensuring that when people run for a position in NUS, they get reimbursed. Like, you pay hundreds to be in this election and that money comes out of your pocket. Like, that is completely wrong. And like, I think that's one of the biggest issues. People don't want to get involved in NUS. They feel like power is gripped very tightly in very few hands. And I think even running to be in this election in itself is a form of resistance. And I would like to encourage more students to do so. And I would try to do that working with the youth development team, for example.
Thank you very much.
So, Savannah, your question is, what have you done in response to the Green Paper?
My entire life.
Yeah.
Okay, so the Green Paper came out on the 6th of November. I like remember the day, and we were gearing up towards it, and we tried to like, even before it came out, we tried to find out what was more likely to be announced, what kind of whispers were going on in the sector, so we'd like fully prepare and get full gear for when it came out. It came out on the 6th of November, and at 9 o'clock in the morning, NUS has sent out communications digesting the entire Green Paper that was announced at midnight. So we worked very hard overnight to get student unions informed and and digesting the whole of 35,000 words, quite a technical and long document, so that you knew what the plans were. And by 4 p.m. on that Friday that it came out, we had a 7-page briefing detailing the different reforms that were being pushed through and what our stance was, and I released a blog on it as well. And since in between the 6th of November and the 15th of January, which was the date when the Green Paper closed, so for those that don't know, the Green Paper is a consultation document that the government releases when they want to change a particular area of policy, and this was the Heritage Nation Green Paper. And so it got released as a consultation open to the sector, and from November until the 15th of January, I've really focused on truly forming a united response from students' unions and getting the student voice heard on the really, really damaging plans that the Higher Education Green Paper contains, namely the introduction of a teaching excellence framework that is planning to raise tuition fees and also create a differentiated tuition fee market between institutions and basically undo a lot of work on access and widening participation that NUS and the students movement have been making strides on in the past years. We've launched a campaign called Quality Doesn't Grow on Fees, and we've sent materials to student unions around the country, even translated them in Welsh for our Welsh unions. Hello, anyone in Wales watching? Yeah, they got the materials in Welsh. And we've encouraged student unions to go out and actually talk to students, talk to your course reps about how exactly those plans will be changing education in a way that we wouldn't be able to recognise it again, and how to fight against it. So it was a customizable campaign that different types of student unions and different types of institutions can pick up and see how the plans would be affecting them, because it would affect an arts or a small and specialist institution way differently from a Russell Group institution. And I've also had personal conversations with small and specialist officers and presidents of arts and specialist institutions, because I think they'll be hardly hit by the plans. And come January, we had a really a huge response to the Green Paper, and the sector kind of followed suit after NUS actually came out with quite a robust response to it. So we're gonna get a higher education bill in May, and we're ready for the fight, I think.
Thank you. Right, so there weren't any questions submitted, but are there anyone have any questions for HG? Yes, go on then.
If you're a bag of crisps. What bag of crisps?
Okay, then. Right. Fine, go on. If you were a bag of crisps, what would you be? Well, I'm down my bed. I have topical questions. Anyway.
You can come up. Yeah. Kettle sweet chili.
Okay, thank you both so much. Thank you very much. Round of applause for the campaign. Thank you. Right, so next up, we're going to grab candidates for union development. Oh, this stop and sit. What did I do last time? Stop and sit, sorry. Right, so we've got a question each of you. I've got Robbie to come in. I said, what should the NUS's role be in supporting student workers against exploitation of precarious zero-hour contracts, especially in the context of attacks on trade unions and working conditions across society? Of course I can. What should the NUS's role be in supporting student workers against exploitation and precarious zero-hour contracts, especially in the context of attacks on trade unions and working conditions across society?
Cool. So I think NUS's role in this is to support the workers, first and foremost. I think we do that by one of the manifesto points is to work with the TUC about getting trade unionism in student unions, because it's not, and the staff and student staff aren't really unionised at the moment, and that's something that I definitely want to work with. I think NUS has a policy actually that says it's okay with zero contracts. For myself, zero contracts was good for me when I was a student, because when I was trained as a lecturer for my PGCE, I wouldn't have been able to work with minimum 8 or whatever hours. So I think actually zero contracts, although I'm supportive outside of the student world, we should be doing the best to support students in their decisions on how they want to do that. And I also think the trade union movement is under attack in that sort of question. And we see that politically, and we can see that through the TU bill. I think it's disgusting that the government wants to create arbitrary figures like 50% for strike ballot when that government got elected on 29%. This is a clear attack on trade union movement and something that the student movement should be and will be united against if I'm elected. Thank you very much.
Next question to Samaya from Sheila. What have you done and what do you plan to do RE to prevent the gender and the refugee crisis?
Okay. So I was the first student in the UK who recognised that Prevent was damaging to our student unions. I realised that there was a Prevent officer following me around, asking questions and asking for my details. So I took the issue straight to the Vice-Chancellor and managed to get policy through our student union and got the Prevent officer kicked off campus. And it was then really that I started speaking to other Black and Muslim students across the region, across the UK, and took policy to the Black Students Campaign and got it passed. And eventually I've seen it come to national conference and pass there as well with the massive Students Not Suspects tour. I've led over 50 workshops on Prevent, training students, getting them to understand really the intricacies around the document, the strategy itself, but then also how it affects you in everyday life. And I've been very, very proud to see actually the representatives of the NUS, the Home Affairs Select Committee. And also when Maria went to the UN, I thought that was that was the biggest vindication of my work on Prevent. I've also organised the biggest youth consultation with the Home Affairs Select Committee that was based in the north of England, where the Home Affairs Select Committee came to Bradford. And I've done loads and loads and loads, and I can't remember the rest. On refugees, I co-organised a student delegation to Calais of 50 people. We recognised that there was a need for practical solidarity and aid and helping aid go through the warehouses, but then we also realised that really the narrative around the refugees is really skewed. The fact that people aren't really understanding why people are stuck in Calais and obviously what's going on, the way that what's going on in the rest of the world is now on our doorstep and the responsibility that we have. And I think that and what we took back from that was the narrative really needs to be changed. We need to be reframing the way that we approach the refugee crisis, but the fact that it's a political problem that needs a political solution, but also that student unions are brilliant resources to be working with in their local communities. I've worked with local refugee groups in Bradford, and I continue to do so. And I think that that's things like volunteering and time, things that student unions do really, really, really well. I think if we see that replicated across the country, I think that's kind of like the gist of what I've done.
Thank you very much. Okay, your question is, does NUS have policies about support or strikes? You don't need to definitely know that, don't worry. So if you do, if so, do you agree? How should this be carried out? If not, what do you think that it should?
Sorry, I don't know if NUS has policies to support or strikes.
Yeah.
I think it depends on what the circumstances are, and I think it depends on, going back similarly to the demo question, it depends on what the circumstances are and what the most appropriate form of action is. But I believe if our members are coming to us, so if it's student unions or students who are coming to us, or anyone that we are allies to, and they believe that they need our support on the strike, then I believe that we should do all we can to support them. If it's someone that we are there to represent and we feel that it's beneficial to.
Thank you very much. Right, so this is the last question to all of you. How would you increase BAME participation, so Black, Asian, minority ethnic participation in student politics? But that's a question to all submit, so you can all answer it.
In terms of this area, it's actually something like me, myself, and one of the managers in the Students' Union. I've worked on quite a lot. I think we're one of only two unions to have an equality department in the whole of the UK. And we've had a real kind of access strategy for the last sort of 3 years. We have had a predominantly white leadership for years and years and years, and predominantly not accessible at all in Bournemouth. And we've basically worked at reaching out to different student groups and figuring out what it is that they want and what it is that they need, and trying to tackle the barriers head on. And this year we saw more BAME students take part in elections than ever before, as well as more postgrads than we've ever seen run, more international students we've ever seen run, and more mature students we've ever seen run. And my successor will be our first ever black, not only our first ever black president, but our first ever black sabbatical officer, which is clearly a bad thing, but also incredibly good. And he's our, you know, a bad thing that it's taken this long. And he's our first ever international student we've ever seen stand for election, or we've ever seen win an election either. So I feel like the work we've done in Bournemouth, I'm really, really proud of it. And it's obviously not just down to me, but it's something that I've worked on and something I've helped to lead on as well. In terms of taking this forward in the student union, in the NUS story, I think, obviously, I'm not one to talk, but I think it's an important issue to, I feel like NUS gives us so much, I feel like I've learned so much about liberation in NUS, and I feel like, I did not try and go to the NUS conference, I went to a women leadership conference, and I went, we haven't got a gender problem, what are they talking about? Like, I feel like, I've learned so much about liberation since I've been involved in the student movement, and I think we need to make it a more accessible space for people to have those conversations, people to go on the same journey that I did. And I believe that we also need to start, one of my manifesto points is about liberating FE as well. We need to start going into FE and sixth form, and we need to start teaching people about these issues from a young age. So they grow up with, as I think that we have a responsibility to do it as a lobbying body. So that students grow up understanding the privilege that they've got, and understanding oppression, and understanding what inequality is. I think a massive problem in society at the moment is people just don't get it. People with privilege don't know that they've got privilege, and I think we need to start changing the culture of people. And just NUS in general, I think we need to make sure that we're as accessible as possible so that people can go into those spaces and learn for themselves as well. I think going into an area in NUS where people don't feel like they can take part is a massive problem, because then people won't learn the same things that I learn through the student movement. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I'm not going to give away how long I've been in the student movement, but I was a part-time officer at Bradford SU for 2 years, and I was the BME officer. And one of the things I really, really tried to do was increase the representation within the Students' Union, with a 65% BME population in Bradford. Like, we're really, really lucky in that, you know, a lot of times our student representation is pretty on point. But one year it didn't happen like that. The year before I got elected as a full-time officer. And it was, and that was a reaction. That was a lot of it was the hostility to BME people in so-called places of power. That's one of the things that I've had to tackle, because it's not just about increasing the certain BME faces in lots of high places. It's about making sure that they're able to stay there, and that they're not given to give them, you know, the lion's share of the work, and then, you know, put on a pedestal, and then completely drop down when they're not able to deal with it, when there's really, really rampant racism in student unions, when you're not taken seriously, when you're completely shut out of places. Those are some of the things that SABs are facing in student unions, and BME SABs are facing in student unions. And I think that we've done through the Black Students Campaign, we've done really, really good work in getting people elected. I know I've travelled to campuses to help SABs get elected. I know I've given advice, like, on the phone in the middle of the night about people who are really, really distressed about running. And I've been that person. I've been that person in elections where I've just had to ring people up and said, I'm really stressed. I don't want to run in this election. And that's where we need to now focus our efforts, because it's all well and good getting people elected, but having them stay there, having them feel comfortable there, is another thing entirely. And that's replicated in NUS. When I got elected onto NEC, I thought, oh, okay, this is an interesting space to be, and I was lumped into a box as soon as I got there. And to be honest, NEC now gives me migraines, and that is now a trigger for my migraines, simply because of the atmosphere that it is. I'm not gonna. I feel really guilty when I say to people, you need to, you know, get elected into places, you need to get elected into SUs, you need to be getting elected onto NEC, because look, it's given me so much experience. But I know 2 years down the line, they're gonna feel like absolute crap, just like I do. And it was a real difficult decision for me to even decide to run in this election. And the fact that I am the only BME person running in that election, I think shows quite a lot. And that's what I feel like this is probably, you know, one of the biggest things that I'm doing. To be a visible Muslim Asian woman in a national election is a really, really, really difficult thing to do. I don't think anyone really appreciates it. I think people really underplay how much of an effect it has on your mental health, on the effect it has on your family, the effect it has on your education, your job prospects, anything and everything. So I think that, you know, we might now be at the place where we're increasing BME representation, but it needs to go further than tokenism, it needs to go further than just lip service, it needs to be actually, it needs to take the form of support when people actually get elected into places.
Section in NUS, Civil Actions Campaign, but also LGBT and Women's and Disabled Students, to talk about how we can make sure that all of the work that is done from I Am the Change Training is intersectional, and all the other campaigns that I want to lead on. And I know, being a Liberation Officer, sometimes campaigns cannot always reflect your movement or your membership. And so, being a Liberation Officer in NUS, one of the things I will do very well, I would like to think, is work closely with all Liberation campaigns, that when we do something, it brings everybody through the movement and so that nobody feels that aren't part of the process. And I think that's something that would really help, because we need to build activists of all identities, especially BAME. I do think that's an issue within NUS. And I think that by doing that, we would start to create more activists on campus and in society, challenging societal norms.
Thank you very much. And I want to say thank you to the candidates of VP Cognitive. Right, up next we have candidates for union development. Yes, right. So, Mr. Mike, so you can go first.
Oh, great.
So, your individual question, Richard, is in your speech last year, you promised to train 1,000 activists on each campus.
Yep.
Have you reached your target?
In my speech last year, I talked about the fact that only by building activists through student unions and by working with every single student union and changing the way we define activism would we be able to basically create an unstoppable student movement. So one of the things we've done is in May we're going to have the Leadership Academy, which is for the first time going to be offering bespoke training to student leaders on 10 student unions, which will be the pilot. I've done a lot more work this year than previously in Vice President Development in terms of going specifically to different student groups. So a priority I've made has been working with different student groups, going to student opportunities, sports teams, societies, fundraising, their student training, going to different events within student unions around that. And we're doing more and more in terms of things we do like regional events, so things like SU locals and how and volunteer training. And actually, one of the things that I think we need to prioritise on, we've done for the first time this year, is about the mental health and also the basically the feeling of volunteers within student unions. So when you talk about activists, you talk about basically students who want to change stuff, which is what student unions are made of. And NUS as an organisation is not focused on volunteers within student unions, those activists. So we, for the first time, we've done a volunteer survey, and then we do a staff survey to find out about their experiences, what works and what doesn't work. So I like to think that I've done a number of different things that have gone past the first barrier of student unions, which is just the full-time elected officers to go underneath that. Thank you very much.
And so, Mahia, your question is, how do you make NUS more relevant to students who are not engaged with their union?
Okay, so I think first of all, we do not want to be some like broken record talking about federal education. However, as somebody who started off in federal education and went to conference last time as like a sole delegate from FE Union, it is sort of frustrating to see actually FE being used as a populist promise that people talk about during elections, but little work actually been done on it. So I think when talking about engagement, it has to be acknowledged that the vast majority of our members don't actually have anything to be engaged in. Unions barely exist in federal education, and when they do, they are completely undemocratic. People do not know when elections take place, and when they do happen, they tend to be in the autumn, which basically means that all our federal education officers do a complete shutout of NUS officer training. So I think first of all, we do need to actually prioritise building the basics of actually having unions where the majority of our movement, 5 million of our students, actually have something to be engaged in. I think more broadly, we need to be, as a movement, we need to actually be taking action on actually the issues that are sort of relevant, and that isn't just a matter of responding because there's a need to respond in some way. It's actually about looking at the most effective ways of actually tackling the onslaught of attacks on education. So I think if we want to see a truly engaged student movement as well as student unions, we have to actually start looking at what student unions are capable of doing and actually empowering people through that.
Thank you very much. This question is to both of you. And it says, as VPUD, what would you do for international students?
There are two main things. One is that we have really happily seen the proliferation in full-time international student officers and student unions, and in more active part-time student union officers in international students. So one of the things that I would like to do is one of the things to talk about the manifesto is change and diversify the way in which we offer training to student unions. So right now, we reformed the officer development program in my first year as VPUD. I was really proud of it. But it's actually in a very set-specific way, which is that your student union basically is a one-campus site, HE, if you have president, vice president of welfare education, and actually a lot of student unions aren't based in that one anymore. So that's number one. And then number two is looking at the different ways in which we run democratic events in student unions and how we support them to be as accessible as possible. And there are loads of different cultural and language reasons why the way in which student unions currently run their elections and actually democratic events in general aren't particularly accessible to international students. So I'd like to do those two things.
Thank you. But yeah, first of all, I've been incredibly saddened and absolutely appalled to see the frightening number of international students who've been faced with deportation. The Home Office has been responsible for deporting up to 48,000 international students, and I think this is absolutely horrendous. I've been, however, very inspired by a lot of the work that student unions, officers and activists have done across the country, most recently in like Strike at University, where they were campaigning against the deportation of the recently elected refugee and asylum, Scottish refugee and asylum seeker officer. And even though we have seen absolutely incredible work being done by student unions and activists, people have essentially had to build campaigns in a matter of hours to respond to the imminent deportation of their students. We need our national union to actually be equipping our officers and our unions to actually be able to deal with deportations and to actually support students when faced with generally issues to ranging related to immigration. So I think this is both, it's twofold. It's both about training, like I said, our officers and our unions, so that includes us staff, so that people are actually able to run such campaigns when faced with deportation cases, but also actually looking at the sort of structural work that can be done, such as actually offering unbiased immigration advice to the student union. We see really incredible work on this topic being done by Sheffield Students Union, and this is something I'd like to see NUS actually explore further and actually encourage and support student unions actually providing this service.
Thank you very much. I did have one more question, but I've seen it's 8 o'clock, so quick answer, okay? So for both of you, how do you think NUS should fight back against the trade union bill?
So, quick answer, right? Right, so the trade union bill has to be seen in the context of basically this government who have a massive problem with the rights of collective organising, basically progressive people up and down the country. So you have to see that in the context of the trade union bill and the things we spoke about earlier, the way in which the Charities Commission is acting, which is containing the political rights of student unions, and just political organising in general. So I think that one of the forefronts of what NUS should be doing as a representative of student unions and for students is absolutely taking the arguments and the lobbying that we have done in terms of the rights of collective organising back to government and put legitimate, credible arguments forward as to the real reasons behind what these reforms are, which are nothing short of just trying to undermine the rights of people who are in opposition to a Conservative majority government. So what I'd like to see is continued work with the trade union campaign, trade union bill campaign,
the extension of workers' rights, more people involved in trade unions and student unions. And actually, one of the things I'm really proud of this year is the Love Issues campaign, which we should absolutely extend, which was all about the capacity and the impact of student unions and basically progressive students up and down the country who organise to make the lives of others better in the name of like collectivism and unity. Is that sure?
Cool. Thank you.
I think that the NUS should be continuing the work that Richard talked about, but we need to actually be clear about why student unions are under attack, and that's because of the threat they pose. Our power as a movement actually allows and our ability to collectively, democratically organise, the way we do that is through our student unions, and that is why they're a danger. And as much as I think it's obviously student unions do many very important, incredibly valuable work to sports, societies and clubs, this isn't the reason why student unions are a threat. You know, there's easily an argument that can be made that these things can easily be provided by sort of private service providers. We need to be talking openly about why student unions are a threat, and that needs to be central to combating actually all attacks and burden restrictions on student union organising. And I completely agree that we do need to actually be working alongside other unions as well as grassroots campaigns such as Right to Strike to actually fight these further restrictions on student union organising and our ability and our power as a movement.
Thank you very much. So last but not least, is last but not least, it is a candidate for Free Be Well Now.
So, I've got two questions for you. First one is, Ian Duncan Smith has recently resigned. What does this mean for the future of our welfare state?
Yeah. Well, that's good, isn't it? We might say it first. I was actually teamed up with the Disabled Students Campaign, Maddie and her colleagues, as well as the Disabled People Against Cuts, the Impact Group, and a couple of trade unions to hold a protest outside the Department of Work and Pensions last term. And this was about kind of raising awareness of the Welfare and Work Bill and the huge attack that it had to bear on people benefits. And we went along and we wore masks with his face on that I made that morning. And we kind of sang some Christmas carols actually, but we changed the words to talk about why we thought he should resign. Little did we think actually a few months later he would, which is obviously fantastic, but his legacy is left behind. There's a new minister in post who agrees with pretty much everything that he's done. So I think actually his resignation was quite cynical. I don't think we should take it as being very representative for the future of the welfare state, and we need to continue fighting. It was only a couple of years ago that me and my mum went through the courts to appeal her benefits being cut back. I know there's been hundreds of thousands of people since then who've had their benefits cut. So this is a real issue and something I want to continue working with the Disabled Students campaign on, but also building up those coalitions in the wider community, because it's students when they graduate and go on to apply for benefits, it's students' families who are having their benefits cut back. It's not just students while they're in education that are being affected. It's a much bigger issue than that.
Thank you very much. And your second question is, BME's mental health is in crisis. What have you done or will you do to improve our situation?
Great question. I guess one of the first times I realised that BME mental health was a particular issue was when I went to FOSIS conference, which is the Federation of Students and Societies, and one of the delegates raised there with me the fact that he doesn't feel like he can go and access mental health services for fear of being racially profiled, because we know that the Prevent agenda is being implemented amongst counsellors and other people in the healthcare profession. And obviously, the Prevent agenda is something that I've been very active in combating this year, and I want to take that to the next level next year in building links with trade unions like Unison, who we've not worked with yet, who represent those staff. But one thing I have done this year is build up a partnership with BACS, which is the basically the body which represents counsellors in colleges and universities. And this is something that they're very concerned about. It's not something they want to be implementing. So I think that's something we could really work with them together on. But also, I think we need to be looking at the reasons why BME students, black students, are experiencing mental health problems disproportionately. So it's not just about student unions coming in and picking up the pieces of broken systems that are failing these students, but actually it's the racism, it's the oppression they're experiencing on campus, it's forcing them into mental ill health and making them feel like, A, they can't access any services, but B, when they get there, they're being failed. So that's something I obviously want to work with the Black Students campaign on and other colleagues, but yeah, thank you for those questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming on. What we're going to do is, when this has been edited and released tomorrow morning, we will also put in the speech that the other candidate, Munya, submitted for the technical difficulties we couldn't play right now. But you can all watch it later, because I know you're all going to watch this video over and over again. Okay, so actually, that we come to the end of this hustings. Across the country to come to Manchester for this hosting. And don't forget to vote Manchester students to vote in the primary, which opens tomorrow. Okay, thank you very much.
Hello everyone, sorry that I couldn't be there, and I hope it's going well up there in Manchester. I'm not really feeling too well, so I'm giving you guys hugs and kisses from Surrey. I'm a sabbatical officer at Surrey Students Union. My name is Munya Mudawike, and I'm running for VP Welfare of the NUS. I currently sit on the Welfare Zone Committee and on NEC. For those that don't know, that's the National Executive Council of the NUS. And to be honest, I never thought I'd get to this point, because a year ago, my union held a referendum on whether or not to disaffiliate with the NUS. But our students now leave voted to stay. In the closest referendum we've ever held on the subject, we chose to stay in the NUS. Our students wanted to leave because the NUS did not seem relevant to them and their issues. The NUS policies being discussed and the methods being used to achieve these goals were not what my students really wanted, and we did not feel that we were getting the support that we needed. So why am I running for a national role, given all this history? Because I want things to change, which I know you hear a few times over the course of this election, but believe me when I say that NUS does not currently fulfill its promise of uniting the student movement. I want that to change by focusing on policies that matter to students. We know that 1 in 4 people will struggle with a mental health problem at some point in their lives, and that students as a sector of the population are disproportionately contributing to this statistic. Students are struggling, with students waiting months for counselling, the government cutting mental health provision, and with stigma and prejudice within society, we as a collective of students must lead the way to a brighter future in mental health. However, you cannot tackle mental health in isolation. I believe you need to challenge all of the things that contribute to the problem. Student number caps have been removed, placing greater pressure on support services. Resources have not increased to match the increase in students, but yet more is expected of the support services. I will do research into what the baseline of support should look like for institutions of different sizes and types, and ask, as I've said in Motion 306 in National Conference, that the government and HEFCE do not permit an increase in student numbers unless an institution can demonstrate that it has the infrastructure to support them. Recruiting more students does not just affect student support services, it drives up the cost of housing. This means that students search for housing off of campus and fall prey to rogue landlords who are unscrupulous and will charge premium prices for substandard living. We need a better regulated system that prevents things like this from happening. I've submitted Motion 307 to National Conference on this subject, and I hope you'll support this. The Prevent Agenda targets members of society and our student community who already face persecution and are victimized purely because of their faith. Prevent has no place on our campuses or in our society. It has no place in affecting what happens to my family, to my nephews, to my nieces, to my cousins. Many students' unions up and down the country have decided not to comply with Prevent. We must make sure that even though we are campaigning against Prevent and we hold a position of non-compliance, we do not leave our institutions unchecked when developing their approach to implementing the policy. Through our absence in this debate, we risk failing to represent our students. Whilst maintaining our principles and integrity is important, I believe we can do this while effectively representing our students and continuing to take part in the debate. Prevent must be tackled not only through principal protest, but through representation at the table where discussions are being held. We can only effectively challenge these issues that are raised if we make sure we start at a grassroots level. I'll make sure that we are driven as an organisation by the students and the student unions that represent them, developing policy and support through and with students' unions. We have to be pragmatic, but our pragmatism does not diminish our ability to be impactful.